I was boarding then at the Bigirls College in Manila. And I remember quite vividly that a few other girls were gathered about the lobby of our school, looking straight and proper since it was 7 in the morning. And the starch in our long-sleeved uniform had not yet given way. I tried to be brave while I read that my uncle had actually been the last of a distinct school of Philippine poets. My uncle, because he married my aunt. So when the papers brought the news of his death, I felt that some part of me had died too. Forgave him, but one day she had more than she could bear. And when he was really drunk, she tied him into a chair with a strong rope to teach him a lesson. She never saw him drunk again. For as soon as he was able to, he walked out the door and never came back. I was very little at that time, but I remember that shortly after he went away, my aunt put me in a car and sent me to his hotel with her letter from her. Prepared a special kind of lemonade for the two of us. When I sipped solemnly at my glass, he inquired after my aunt. To my surprise, I found myself answering with alacrity. Uncle smiled, his beautiful summer smile, and drew some poems from his desk. He scribbled a dedication on them and instructed me to give them to my aunt. Sophia were holding conference. At first, I couldn't gather much except that uncle was not anymore the topic. It was a woman by the name of Essa. Later, I began to appreciate the subtlety of Spanish La Mujer Essa. Complicated as the situation was when uncle was alive, it became more so when he died. I was puzzling over who was to be the official widow at his funeral. The morning wasn't far gone when I arrived at the chapel, and there were only a few people present. Aunt Sophia was sitting in one of the front pews at the right section of the chapel. Crossing the aisle was a very slight woman in her early 30s who was dressed in a dramatic black outfit with a heavy veil coming up to her forehead. I wanted to ask my aunt who she was, but after embracing me when I arrived, she kept her eyes stolidly fixed before her. I always feel guilty of sacrilege every time I think of it, but there was something grimly ludicrous about my uncle's funeral. Everyone spoke in whispers, and then the voice rose a trifle. Still, everybody was polite. There was more talking back and forth, and suddenly, the conversation wasn't polite anymore. "So you want to put me in a corner, do you?" the woman said. "Please don't create a scene." "Por Dios, make her stop," Aunt Sophia said. "We're only trying to make you see reason," cried Aunt Sophia, her eyes going up to heaven. The woman's voice was now pitched up. "Let's see who has the reason. I understand that you want me to live, isn't it? Let me ask you, during the war, when the poet was hard up, do you suppose I deserted him?" "When he was ill, who was it who stayed at his side? Who took care of him during all those times? And who peddled his books and poems to the publishers so that he could pay for the hospital and doctor's bills? Whose jewels do you think we sold when he did not make money? Did any of you come to him then? Let me ask you that. Now that he is dead, you want me to leave his side so that you and your veja can have the honors and have your picture taken with the president. That's what you want, isn't it? To pose with the president?" At that moment before she fled, I saw what I had waited to see. The mascara had indeed run down her cheeks, but somehow, it wasn't funny at all. My friend said that I shouldn't be so unhappy because my uncle was now with the other great poets in heaven. For the death of the delinquent husband of my aunt. I never really lied about anything, only nobody thought to ask me just how close an uncle he was. It wasn't my doing either, when some months after his demise, my poem entitled "The Rose Was Not So Fair, O Alma Mater," was captioned by the niece of the late beloved Filipino